Please do. Let me first of all thank profusely the Institute that I have been given opportunity to share some of my views here. I've come here for the first time and hope that I'll keep coming here in future. Let me begin by taking you to 1945, when a politician is jailed and he is writing a book which all of us know, and is entitled Discovery of India. Now this politician devotes about 10 to 15 pages to something called scientific temper. Now these 10 pages become extremely important when India got free. When India becomes a free country, then almost the whole nation and who's who of the country are discussing these 10 pages. This triggered a major debate, what is known as scientific temper debate. And in 1948, I'm not talking about constitution, just because I don't have much time. But 1958, India passes a resolution which is known as scientific policy resolution. Now this resolution is placed in the parliament. The prime minister, the same person who was writing his book in the jail, rises and says that every word of this resolution is important, and therefore I am going to read the entire resolution. The entire resolution is read, which is not the norm. Normally in the parliament, whoever is going to present the resolution or any bill says that it's placed and then debate starts. And after that, what follows is much more interesting. The entire opposition is blaming the government and the Prime Minister that why did you not bring this resolution earlier? The rolling plan wouldn't have fallen through if you had brought this resolution earlier. Instead of tearing apart, which is normally the duty of the opposition, the opposition supports each and every word written there in the resolution. Why did it happen? I've been asking this question, and it's a difficult question to answer, because most of the people in the country, which is a country of about 29% people who could write their names, so the literacy level was defined as those who can write their names. And here is a resolution which is placed in the parliament and everybody is supporting it. Why did everybody support this constitution which talks about equality of human being, equality of gender, job for all, scientific temper, etc., etc.? Because most of the people in the country and within the Congress itself, I'm 100% sure, and there is enough evidence to show, that did not believe in these norms in their personal lives. They did not believe in scientific temper in their personal lives. Why did they support this progressive constitution and a resolution which is known as SPR? The only answer is probably that most of them were not confident that they can write such good text. The other answer is probably that the forces that they represented knew that these are some lunatic intellectuals called Nehru and Gandhi and Maulana Azad and Ambedkar. Let them write whatever they want to write. the balance of power in society will not change. That we decide. And they were very, very confident about it. Now here is Nehru, Gandhi, Azad, Ambedkar. These people are surrounded by best of the minds in any field you can imagine of that time. And these people were being groomed as politicians by the environment that was provided by the best of the mind, the Baba of the time, the Bhatnagar, Sir C.V. Raman, or you take any other field, the best of the painters, the best of the writers, poets, everybody was in direct touch with them. So their vision was being formed by the environment in which they grew. Cut to 80s. Here we see 70s and 80s, when those who followed SPR and the model that we know as Nehruvian model were trying to build big laboratories. CSIR grows from 2 laboratories to 37 laboratories. DRDO comes into being. All kinds of disciplines grow up in India. When this process is going on, there is another process going on side by side. The Babas emerging. And the Babas amass not only following, but a huge amount of wealth. Today, if you look at the Google, search Google, then 10 Babas at least have more than 1,000 crore worth property. And when I'm saying more than that, in certain cases, it goes to 40,000 crore. Remember that Chandrayaan budget was 1,000 crore? I would like all these Babas to be put into a launch vehicle with their own money and sent to moon. But this process is happening at the same time. Babas are growing, the following is growing, and gradually there is this nexus getting created between another breed of politicians which has grown in this environment of Babas. You look at BJP leaders, each one of them has gone and touched the feet of some Baba or the other. I'm not saying that Congress leaders did not do it, but I'm saying that the topmost leadership of BJP went to one Baba who is behind the bars today, at least, and touched their feet. Now, this political leadership which is growing in this atmosphere after the globalization period, the forces that have been unleashed within the country realize that Nehruvian model will not work anymore. So they hunt and search the most illiterate chief minister. And I take our prime minister's word for his qualification. He is on record saying that he is not very qualified, he is only 10th pass. So I'm not getting into the controversy that what happened in Delhi University, etc., etc. He himself says he is 10th pass. This is the lowest qualification of any chief minister up till now. He is the most violent person because he has presided over 2002 carnage. And this person is selected and launched by these forces and catapulted to the Prime Minister's chair. Within 1 month of coming to power, he addresses a gathering of scientific experts and says Ganesha is the evidence of plastic surgery. such assertions have been made in the past. There's no doubt about it. There are many books and pamphlets written on such lines. My colleagues have given a large number of examples, so I'm not getting into those examples. But here is a prime minister which comes to power, and within a month he says Karan is an evidence of some scientific excellence. Now we can laugh at it, reject it, and say that here is an illiterate prime minister who is saying such an idiotic thing. No, but hold on, it's something very serious, because it's prime minister of the country who is making such assertion. It's a political statement that he is making. It's a statement on which now onwards the policies of the countries would be shaped. He is instructing his own people to make a statement with impunity which will attack rationality in the country. So all those statements which have been made by MHRD minister or a judge or a chief minister cannot be just laughed at. They have to be taken extremely seriously. These are statements which would govern the country in times to come, and that is exactly what we have seen. The Babas become more and more powerful. They operate within the country with impunity. And here is political leadership in which one of the chief ministers, and he had no reason to say such a thing, but he comes to power, and within few days he makes an assertion that we had television, and since we had television, so we had satellite, and we had satellite, so we had launch vehicles, and if we had launch vehicles, we did have atom bomb in the country. You may call me alarmist, and you may say that how does it matter if some lunatics are making such anti-science statements, so forget about it, these are politicians and it doesn't matter. Tomorrow will change when some other political party comes to power which is more close to scientific rationality, then we'll change. How does it matter? No. It does matter. It is reflected in what happens in IITs. It is reflected in what happens in institutions like CSIR, DRDO, Atomic Energy, and many other institutions. Hundreds of projects have been given to study what is called as pseudoscience. The science budget is cut on the one hand, and then IIT Delhi is investigating what is there in Panchgavya. It's a big major project. Every year international meet is organized, and it's going to be organized in November, this time in Calcutta, which propagates very consciously pseudoscience in the country. And the budget has been increasing since 2014 when it was started, and there's a lot of corruption involved in it. The first one was organized in IIT Delhi, and it is led by an RSS organization. Kharagpur, you have a course introduced which is pseudoscience. So on the one hand, what is happening is that the science budget is being cut. On the other hand, whatever money is available is getting diverted to pseudoscience. Okay, fine. You can again tell me that when the times change, we'll change the thing. We'll stop these projects, and we'll take up new ones, which are purely scientific projects. No. If you look at the output, scientific output of the country, it was rising at a very fast rate before 2014. After 2014, the papers published in reputed journals has gone down. The rate of rise has gone down to the level where we were at the turn of the century. We have moved backwards by 19 years. I think that this is the biggest crime that this government has committed. Because what decisions were taken, what resolutions were passed 70 years back, because of that, today, in certain areas of science, we are in the forefront of scientific discoveries and publications. Now, once they have damaged scientific institutions, scientific culture, and we lag today behind, will have an impact in times to come. Thank you.